George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?
Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the book From Glory Days and your host of the show. Today's guest was an athletic and academic All-American at Michigan State University. Together with legendary teammates like Irvin Magic Johnson, he won a national championship in 1979 and became a first-round draft pick by the Detroit Pistons. Following his six seasons in the NBA, our guest went on to become an acclaimed sports broadcaster and is best known as a color commentator during Detroit Pistons TV broadcast. Let's give our guest a nice warm welcome, Greg Kelser.
Thank you, Kurt.
Greg, we got a special taping end of this episode. We're at the Volunteers of America Veteran Housing Program here in Lansing, Michigan. And you had a connection to Lansing. At some point, you decided to come to Lansing. Let's talk about that. Michigan State University. Why Michigan State University?
Well, it was many years ago. I came to Michigan State because of a relationship that was forged between the coaching staff at that time and my family, you know, my parents. Gus Kanakis was the head coach. Vernon Payne was his chief assistant. And they spent a lot of time in the Detroit area and at my high school recruiting me. They got to know my parents, and a friendship grew out of that. And I actually came to Michigan State as a result of that relationship. I had never seen the university. I had never been in Lansing. I'd only been living in Michigan a short time because my dad was in the Air Force, and we settled here after he retired from the Air Force. So I came here on that relationship. Later on, I took a visit, decided I liked the campus, and the rest is history, but it was a relationship. That's the main reason why I came to Michigan State.
And the coaching relationship changed during your tenure
here.
Yeah,
it was devastating. After my first year, head coach Gus Kanakis was replaced by the legendary Judd Heathcote. It was great because for me, as I look back on it, because I got started with Gus, who had tremendous faith in me and allowed me to start as a freshman, which was not very popular at that time. Freshmen had only been eligible to play varsity basketball for 2 or 3 years, but he put me in. He allowed me to grow my confidence and become an integral part of the team as a freshman. Judd Heathcote, who was a great coach, came in and sort of took the baton and helped me to continue to develop and eventually become a professional athlete. But at the time it happened, it was devastating because I came here to play for Gus. He was replaced, and for a short period of time, I seriously considered leaving, which now we all know would have been a big mistake.
What kept you here then at that point?
Really, it was Gus Kanakis himself saying to me, you know, Greg, even though I'm not going to be your coach, this is the place for you. This is where you belong. And my parents, they too wanted me to stay, though they were ready to support any decision that I would make. But, you know, my dad felt like, you know, if you run from this, it's a challenge, it's an adjustment. If you run from this, you'll be running from everything when it gets tough. So, you know, in that message, I heard him loud and clear. You should stay and stick it out.
How do you think that helped you towards the championship? Ultimately, obviously, we know the history of what happened.
Well, anytime you're trying to win a championship and you're part of a team, there are going to be hurdles, there are going to be setbacks, and we certainly had them here as part of the Michigan State team in 1979. We had to pick ourselves up from some certain depths at that time to even get to the tournament, but we had a lot of faith in our potential as a team. We knew we were better than we were playing at that particular time, and we recommitted ourselves during the midway point of the season, and we were able to win 15 of our last 16 games, including the championship. But I guess the biggest thing, though, when you talk about, you know, lessons like that, sticking to it when things are tough, and so many other lessons that you learn during the course of participating in sports, I carry those with me today. Because even though I'm not an athlete anymore, you know, there's still challenges in my job, there's still challenges in your everyday endeavors, family, all of that. And a lot of times I find myself looking back on the lessons that I learned as an athlete to help guide me through the challenges of today.
We want to bring those lessons up shortly, but let's talk about the pinnacle, that 1979 championship here at Michigan State. What did that mean to you?
When I came here to Michigan State, I was told that I would have a chance to win a national championship before my career was up. And they talked about, you know, having the chance to play with guys like Irvin Johnson and Jay Vincent, a couple of Lansing products, and that they would surround us all with, you know, with good players, good athletes that would give us that opportunity. So for me, it was the culmination of a promise and a dream. They sold a dream. I bought into it. It sounded easy at the time. Of course, it wasn't. But we were successful in getting those great athletes from Lansing and the other great players that we were able to recruit. And we won our championship. And fortunately for me, I was the only senior on that team. So for me, it was my last shot. Mm-hmm. I'm glad it happened. You know, and it that thing is just tremendous. I mean, it still serves today. People still remember the championship. People remember champions. You know, people respect winning and the honor that comes with that, because I think by and large people understand that it doesn't happen in a day. It's a commitment, and it's something that that you earn. It's not handed to you.
So it happened to you before your senior year, but it wasn't the end of the story as far as your playing career. What happened from there?
Well, I was able to parlay my career here at Michigan State into being drafted the number 4 player selected in the draft in 1979. My teammate, Irvin Magic Johnson, was first to the Lakers, and a couple of players later, 3 players later, I was selected by the Detroit Pistons. So that, too, was a big dream come true, because from the time I started playing basketball, which was around age 10 for organized basketball, I dreamed of playing in the NBA. I had a strong belief that I would be good enough. And, you know, I tell people all the time, this was long before I was 6'8" tall.
Though you were lanky and skinny at that time.
I was lanky and skinny. And when I got to Michigan State, I think I weighed 185, maybe 190 pounds. But I had quickness, mm-hmm. and leaping ability, and I had a desire.
How'd that quickness help you in the NBA?
Tremendously, until the knees became a problem, and it certainly curtailed some of my ability to do things that I was able to do to be effective out on the basketball court. But I'm very thankful. You know, I played 6 years in the NBA. I tell people all the time, the game owes you nothing. Nothing. I had a lot of fun playing basketball, and fortunately it was able to help me earn a scholarship to Michigan State, which allowed my parents to not have to worry about paying for my education, which they were perfectly ready to do and had promised throughout. It also allowed me to play professionally, which is something I thoroughly enjoyed. It allowed me to build a financial foundation as a youngster, and so the game was awfully good to me. But I still say the game owes you nothing. I tried to use basketball though as much as I could.
And you brought up about education. Before we go too far, I want to bring that up. Most people know that you're an athletic All-American. Not too many people knew that you're also an academic All-American.
Yeah, that's true. I'm not going to say that I set out to do that, but you know, I had 2 parents that pushed me all the time to do the best you could be, you know, do the best you can, be the best you can be. They used to always say, if you're going to do anything, do it well. So I took that into the classroom, and it just so happened that it worked out that way. My parents used to always say, you should put the same amount of energy in the classroom that you put on the court. So that was always in the back of my mind. So I strived to get the very best grades, and lo and behold, it was enough to garner that honor.
Who do you think was more proud, your parents or yourself, of that honor?
Oh, definitely. Definitely my parents. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were very, very proud of that. But I'm reaping the benefits now, because getting an education, being prepared to do other things aside from basketball, when my career ended after 6 years, it wasn't a point of devastation for me. It was a point of adjustment. It was a period of a great adjustment doing something else. But the trepidation that would normally go along with having to give up something like your professional basketball career, mm-hmm. wasn't as damaging or as critical as one might think.
You had that foundation of an education to fall back on, so to speak. So mm-hmm. I think I heard you say one time before that you've played far more times for free than you ever did for pay.
Oh, yeah. You know, when you're growing up, you can't wait to get out on the playground, and that's all I did. You know, it's not like now where you have to be a little bit more sensitive and careful where your kids are. You don't just let them roam free. Well, back in those days, and I'm sure you can relate, As soon as we got home from school and got our homework done, it was out to the playground to play basketball. And on the weekends, I would leave my house at 8 or 9 in the morning. My parents might not see me again until 6 or whenever the street lights came on. And all I did was play mm-hmm. sports. You know, I played mm-hmm. basketball, football, and baseball. But clearly, basketball was my best sport. I definitely played far more for free. But it was playing free for free that got me to the play for pay stage.
Well, and unfortunately, at some point, you mentioned earlier about the injuries that started occurring, that pay for play or pay for, you know, playing to pay, had to end at some point. Let's talk about some of the greatness. The hard part for you, though, coming out of college, you had a national championship under yeah. your belt. And unfortunately, at that time, when you came to the Pistons, it wasn't quite the championship-type team at that point.
No. You know, there was some talk that I was going to be drafted by the Seattle Supersonics, who were the defending champions in 1979. They had just won their championship, and I liked that idea. I liked the idea of maybe having a chance to win a championship at Michigan State and then go right into a championship-contending situation in the NBA. Seattle, through some trades in prior years, had the 6th and 7th pick that year. Irving got to the Lakers because of a trade they had made, so he went right into a winning situation. I landed at the Pistons. The Pistons were not one of the better teams in the NBA. That's one of the byproducts of playing well in college and being one of the top players in college. You usually, you know, go to a bad team because mm-hmm. the bad teams pick first in the NBA draft. So I went to the Pistons, and it was a rebuilding process. We were a young team. We had 5 rookies on that first on my first year team. So we were not going to win a whole lot. Mm-hmm. That was difficult to deal with. Obviously, I was used to winning. Had grown to really like it. Had always won. So that was a great adjustment in itself, mm-hmm. Learning how to deal with defeat and knowing that, you know, it was going to take some time to get to the stature that we had hoped for.
But it did happen. You eventually went over in Seattle as yeah. well, though, at some point. Had a yeah. trade, and that was a little different taste for you at that time then as well. They started winning. They were doing playoffs.
Well, when I went to Seattle, you know, I was fortunate that the Pistons traded me to one of the better teams in the league. So immediately I was back in a winning situation, and I really, really enjoyed that. But it was somewhat bittersweet because when I was traded from the Pistons, it was right around the time that organization was ready to turn the corner. They had drafted Isaiah Thomas, had Kelly Chipuka, had, you know, some other good players come mm-hmm. in. So the Detroit Pistons were no longer going to be one of the worst teams in the league. And I sort of liked the idea of maybe sticking around being a part of that. I likened it to when I got to Michigan State. We had to build in order to get to the mm-hmm. to the point of greatness. The journey was tough, but the final result was tremendous. So I was hoping to live that same sequence with the Pistons, but it didn't work out that way.
You end up Seattle, also out with the Clippers as well. And one of the things that happened, you started having knee problems. I think that it slowed you down. And you mentioned earlier your gift was your speed, but you couldn't play as fast yeah. anymore.
I actually got hurt and had knee surgery my second year in the NBA. But I was blessed. I was fortunate to be able to rehab as much as I possibly could and get back. Not to 100%, but mm-hmm. enough to stay in the NBA and play 4 or 5 more years. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm thankful. Again, as I say, the game owes you nothing. I played 6 years in the NBA. That's 6 years more mm-hmm. than most people. I would have loved to have played 15 years, but it did not work out that way. But, you know, thankfully, I'm still involved with the game and doing something that I envisioned myself doing while I was still playing.
Mm-hmm. Professional athletes take a 90-95% pay cut when they're done playing like that. What were some of the challenges that you might have experienced as a result of not playing professional sports anymore?
Well, I took a pay cut. There's no question about that. I took a pay cut at that time. But, you know, the 90% pay cut, fortunately, I did not spend 90% of my money that I earned in 6 years. Mm-hmm. I still had that. So that allowed me to make my transition, again, make it smoothly, take my time, decide which direction I wanted to go. I knew I wanted to work in broadcasting, but, you know, wait for the right opportunity so that I could make the most of that chance. Being financially sound in my decision making while I was still playing allowed me that freedom to take my time. The biggest adjustment, I think, for me leaving the NBA was not being able to find that level of competition to play against. It just doesn't exist. Once you play at that level, everything else is a couple of runs
yeah.
down.
Well, Greg, we're going to take a little break right now for our educational minute, but when we come back, more about Greg Kelser's transition from pro basketball.
I love investing, but can I tell you a dirty little secret? In my opinion, the best tool for achieving financial security isn't an investment or an insurance policy, it's a budget. a budget is not a four-letter word. How can you know where your money's going unless you budget? How can you know how much to save for retirement unless you know how much your lifestyle costs? How do you know if you should be saving more for your kids' education unless you know how much that may cost? How can you even set spending and savings goals if you don't know where your money's going? Many of the financial questions that we routinely ask ourselves can only be answered by doing a simple budget. My tip for you is simple. Take the time to develop a budget for your family.
I'm Kurt David, and we're back with our guest, Greg Kelser. Greg, we started talking about that transition out of sports, and you know, the speed was your game, and you knew it was you're losing that since the second year of playing and everything. But what was that transition out when you knew it was done, when you knew it was over? How was that for you?
Well, it wasn't easy. Again, as I said earlier, one of the things that really helped, I knew what I wanted to do post pro athletic career. I had already started to lay the groundwork for that, but I still had a lot of basketball left in me. You know, I was 27, 28 years old, so it wasn't all gone. I had not rid myself of the temptation and the desire and the love for the game playing-wise. So that was difficult. You're not going to find that level of competition no matter how hard you look, and I was accustomed to playing against the best in the world.
Yeah, and you actually started doing some broadcasting at that point. You always were enamored by that and started doing some broadcasting, and that was kind of difficult for you to sit on the sideline.
Oh, yeah.
You're always professional, did your job, of course. But
well, my transition from basketball to being a broadcaster was just 1 year, because I had somewhat, as I said, laid the groundwork. But there were times when I would be behind the table broadcasting the game and watching the athletes out on the floor, and, man, my juices would get the flowing, and I felt like I should be out there. I'm thinking to myself, why am I sitting here? I should be out there. That went on probably for the first 5 years of my career.
Took you 5 years a part of that transition.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
We have a special taping. We're at the Veteran Housing Program here in Lansing, Michigan, and we do a lot of parallels as far as athletes and life, and you know, as far as parallel of transitioning veterans and transitioning professional athletes, a little bit of loss of purpose and direction for a moment.
Yeah. But you know what, I think you always have to feel that like change is coming. Nothing stays the same in any of our lives, and I think the best way to deal with transition and change is to prepare for it early and not wait till it's right upon you. Again, something my dad used to always say to me, you know, he would tell me, I don't care how good you are in basketball, you're not going to play forever, so you need to develop your second and third options. So, you know, again, that helped me tremendously in making whatever transition that I was going to have to make.
And you knew you loved broadcasting. Got into broadcasting how many years now? How long have you been doing this?
Well, I'm moving into year number 26.
Wow, it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's been that many years.
Yeah, and I'm dating myself big time.
So, you know, you're doing the broadcasting. Your face is seen all over on TV, any Piston broadcasts and everything, college games as well. What are some of the other things you're doing in the community or, you know, you're involved? We see you all over the place, Greg.
Well, you know, I try to stay busy. Obviously, basketball and broadcasting is my number one occupation, but you know, for the last 30 years, I've been doing a lot of motivational speaking, a lot like yourself. I speak all over the country. I speak it to corporations. I speak to businesses. I speak to associations, schools, universities. I enjoy the challenge of motivating people to change their way of thinking, maybe change their way of going about things, to realize the champion that I believe resides in all of us.
How do you do that?
Well, you know what? I like to cite examples from my life, use stories that are easily relatable and allow people to see that even the most successful people are not that much different than anyone else, you know, and that the thing that sometimes we have to do is just dig a little deeper. The thing that we have to do is stay motivated and not let our downfalls or our setbacks define us.
You mentioned about the lessons you learned from sports. Parallels there?
Oh, my God, yes. You know, the challenge of deciding to stay at Michigan State when it was very much my desire, or at least I thought as an 18-year-old, to leave when my head coach, who I came here to play for, was transitioned. And my father telling me, you got to stick with that. You know, I use that in some of my speeches. I talk about, you know, when we're confronted with a different manager or a different supervisor coming in and changing the whole makeup of the department and how tough that adjustment can be. And you know, sometimes you can run from it, or sometimes you can stay there and try and make it work. And for me, I'm very thankful that I stayed at Michigan State. I don't know what would have happened had I gone to some of the other schools that had come looking to lure me after they found out that I was a little disgruntled. But the decision to stay here has paid off handsomely. And I tell people, you know, if you just stick through it, work through it, you never know the benefit that might be waiting for you.
Yeah, and you give back. I mean, you're involved with the community. What kind of things are you doing in the community now?
Well, you know, I have my basketball camps as well that I run in the summertime. And we have been fortunate enough to get individuals and companies involved with us that provide funding and scholarships for kids, because one of the big staples of my camps are being able to provide opportunities for especially inner city kids who might not ordinarily be able to afford it financially. We like to have them benefit from the exposure of a week at basketball camp. And the other thing we do at camp, we really, really stress education. Parents love that because most of my coaches and certainly myself, we've been living the part that has been the educational benefit. We've been living that for quite a while, and we can preach to the kids with some validity, with some validation, because we know how important education is. You know, as a kid, you hear it and you're like, okay, but give me the basketball. But we know that it is really the most sustaining benefit that you can have, a sound education.
Well, and what a better spokesperson than somebody who was an athletic All-American and an academic All-American. That has a lot of weight.
Well, thank you. I mean, I thank my parents for that, because I would have probably been happy to just get grades good enough to stay eligible. But that wasn't going to work in my household.
And we're glad it didn't. This is one of my favorite parts of the show, though, Greg. This is when we take some live studio audience question and answer. We're going to have some special questions here from the veterans and public that is here today. So are you ready for those questions?
I'm ready.
Yes, my name is Chris Thomas. I'm from Kalamazoo, Michigan, but I'm residing here at the Veterans Housing Program in Lansing. And I'd like to ask Mr. Kelser, your rookie year with the Pistons, was there anyone who took you under their wing?
Well, Chris, not necessarily with the Pistons, because, again, we were such a young basketball team. I was one of four rookies. Our veteran was Bob Lanier. Bob was a multi-year all-star at that time with the Detroit Pistons, I believe going into his ninth season. But Bob was injured early in the year, so we never really able to benefit from his presence as a veteran. So we were sort of out there on our own. It was much different than my first year at Michigan State, when I had several seniors that were willing to take me under their wing and serve as mentors.
Brian Burrows from Lansing. Mr. Kelser, I was curious, what was your toughest defensive player to play against in the NBA in your professional career? Who would you say was the toughest?
Well, there were several. Larry Bird, first of all, never forgot that we beat them for the national championship. So whenever I would play him, he would try to make up for that every time. He was a nightmare to try to guard. I was also never one to want to see Dr. J coming, because he too was very, very difficult to handle. Those are probably the two toughest covers I ever was assigned to during my basketball career.
And I guess we have one more question as well here.
My name is Dwayne Ferris, Lansing, Michigan, and my question to you is, how important was Mr. Berkovich in your last two games of your national championship run?
A lot of people may not remember Michael Berkovich as part of our national championship game. First of all, Michael Berkovich was not a scholarship athlete when he got to Michigan State. He came and played pickup basketball with us in the summertime, and through that, got the eyes of the coaches, was impressive enough with his shooting ability that he won a spot on our team as a walk-on, was later awarded a scholarship. But by the time we got to to our championship run, he was a starter on the team, and he was the best shooter not only on our team but in the entire Big Ten. And this was before the three-point shot was brought into college basketball. He had unlimited range, and he was very beneficial for our interior people like myself, because you had to go out there on him. He helped spread the floor and made opportunities for us on the inside. So he was vital. We don't win the championship without Michael Berkovich.
Well, Greg, this show is about the transition of professional athletes, but we want it to be beyond that, especially today as we're taping in this special location of Volunteers of America Veterans Housing Program here in Lansing, Michigan. What advice would you have for anybody in transition or that's facing a change in adversity, veteran, professional athlete, anybody? What advice would you have?
I think the biggest thing and the first and most important thing is to believe in yourself and your ability to make change and your ability to adapt, understanding that you are not a one-pronged individual, you know, that we're all multi-talented. And the other thing is to plan ahead. Do not wait till that transition is upon you, because then It can be a little bit more burdensome, but plan ahead and just believe in yourself. Believe in your ability and your God-given talents.
Well, I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, Greg Kelser, for joining us. Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions, please visit my website at jwifinancial.com.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do we do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?